Hello friends, I am CA Jayesh Gogri from Mumbai. In this video, we are going to discuss some of very important amendments made in the CGST Act. Now, the most important term in the entire CGST law, or you may say entire GST law, is the term supply. Now, this word supply has been defined in section 7(1) of the CGST Act. So, section 7 subsection 1 deals with four situations. The first situation says that any supply of goods or services or both which is made in the course or furtherance of business and which is for consideration would be regarded as supply. So, the first subclause says about two things, that in any supply there has to be first of all presence of business, and secondly it has to be for a consideration. The second thing is, there is a supply, the second subclause of section 7 subsection 1 says that any import of services which may or may not be in the course or furtherance of business but which is for a consideration will be considered to be a supply. The third clause says that there could be certain activities which may not be for a consideration but which are defined in schedule 1 will be considered to be supply. So, in first situation, the presence of business as well as consideration both was required. As far as the second situation, for import of services, the requirement of business was not there, only presence of consideration was necessary. In the third scenario, it was exactly reverse, that the presence of consideration is not required. What is needed is, like, it should be in the course or furtherance of business. Now, there is last subclause in section 7(1) which says that the activities will be treated as supply of goods or services which are defined in schedule 2, which are referred in schedule 2. So, if any activity which is referred in schedule 2, it will be regarded as either supply of services or supply of goods as may be defined in that schedule 2. Now, there was a very important question about this clause D, that say for example certain activity which is not normally considered to be supply, it is neither in the course of business nor there is consideration and there is no supply in a normal parlance, but say for example if it is finding place in schedule 2, will that be considered as supply or not? Because schedule 2 normally it is for classification, that whether a supply is for of goods or services, for that classification schedule 2 has been given. But the schedule 2 and the way the subsection 7(1)(d) was defined, it was giving an impression that once something finds place in schedule 2, it will be considered as supply first of all, and then it will be considered to be either goods or service as defined in that schedule 2. So effectively people were having impression that schedule 2 is playing a dual role. It is not only classification, it is also making declaration that this would be regarded as supply. So, there were like various situations. So, say for example, there is like a supply of goods by an association to a member. Now, whether that would be regarded as supply or not, because schedule 2 was defining that is a supply of goods. So, though in normal parlance a supply, the term supply would require presence of two persons. However, in this case, it was happening that there is a probability that even though club and members could be regarded as same person, however, since it's defined in schedule 2, therefore it will be regarded as supply. Now, a very important amendment has been made in this clause D. It has been completely deleted from the retrospective effect of 1st July 2017. So, ever since the GST law was implemented, since then this particular clause has been deleted. And there is one more subsection 1 capital A has been inserted in section 7, which says that where certain activities or transactions constitute a supply in accordance with the provisions of subsection 1, they shall be treated either as supply of goods or supply of services as referred to in schedule 2. Now, this subsection makes it abundantly clear that unless there is a supply of goods, services or both for consideration or business as in the clause E, or there is the import of services which is for consideration, or clause C which says that any supply which may not be for consideration but which is defined in schedule 1. So only these three activities would be considered to be supply, and if they are supply, if any activity fits into any of these three clauses which have been defined in section 7(1), then only you need to look at schedule 2 to identify whether it is a supply of goods or supply of services. So schedule 2 will be subject to your schedule 1 which says that there is a may not be any consideration. It will be also subjected to schedule 3 which says that this kind of activity, schedule 3 gives a list of certain supplies which are considered to be neither supply of goods nor supply of services. So schedule 2 has to be read now if there is supply. If there is no supply per se, then one need not refer to schedule 2. So earlier, which the impression was there that it is clarificatory classification also, it's providing classification as well as making declaration of certain services. Now that doesn't hold good, and since it has been made retrospectively effective, it will have the ramifications where people would have like considered certain activities to be supply. Simply looking at schedule 2 will require a reconsideration, and that will open up various other issues. So first of all, we'll talk about the typical items which are there prescribed in schedule 2, and then we can also discuss that what will be the ramifications if, now looking at this definition, if people feel that it is no more a supply, then what will happen to your taxes which have been paid, or the penalties or whatever which you have been paid, now what can be done. So coming to the schedule 2, there are items which require our attention. The item number 4 in the schedule 2 talks about transfer of business assets. Now the first clause 4A clause says, where goods forming part of the assets of a business are transferred or disposed of by or under the directions of the person carrying on the business so as no longer to form part of those assets, whether or not for a consideration, such transfer or disposal is a supply of goods by the person. So as long as there is a business asset, maybe goods, maybe some capital assets, whatever could be those business assets, if they have been like either transferred or disposed of. Now there are two different words, transfer, disposal. Now the word transfer would require presence of two persons, because one would be transferor, the another would be transferee, there will be involvement of two persons. The word disposal doesn't require presence of another person. Simply one can dispose of. Now this both, whether for consideration or not, it was considered to be a supply. It was considered to be supply of goods. Now friends, if we plainly read, then we can come to know that if there is no consideration, if there is no other person which is there, so we are talking about the disposal which is made without consideration. Now first of all, at the first place, can it be considered to be a supply at all? Because supply, we'll discuss some of the judgments also where it requires presence of two persons. Supply cannot be to oneself, otherwise every time I pick up this mobile and keep in my pocket, it will be considered to be supply to myself, okay. Or every time when I carry this laptop to my home, it will be considered as supply to myself. Supply invariably requires presence of two persons, and because we have got the historical background of the UK, wherein like this UK VAT was like adopted since, I mean, many years ago before this GST was implemented in the India. So in England there is like a House of Lords judgment which says that supply has to have two persons. Supply cannot be made to oneself. We'll come to that decision little later. But when a disposal has been made, a disposal doesn't require presence of another person. then there may not be any consideration. So then in such a situation, unless it finds place in Schedule 1, Schedule 1 says that whether there is a consideration or not, certain activities would be deemed to be supply. So in such situations, fine. But otherwise, barring that Schedule 1, there may not be any situation which can be considered to be supply if there is no consideration and there is no involvement of business. So in such a case, now Schedule 2 need not be looked at all. And then one can say, since it is no supply, though you may call that it will be regarded as supply of goods, but since it is no supply at all, therefore I don't require any classification whether it is goods or service, and therefore I did not pay GST. So this is like one interpretation which comes up after reading the insertion of subsection 1A into section 7 and the deletion of clause D in the section 7.1. So only if there is ITC which has been claimed in respect of certain assets, and then if those assets are disposed of, whether for consideration or not, whatever, then it can be regarded as supply. Otherwise, if ITC has not been availed, then it cannot be regarded as supply. The question may arise that, say for example, this laptop, which was purchased way back in, say, 2015, when there was no GST law, 2016, when there was no GST law, in 2017, prior to 1st July 2017, when there was no GST law. So, and at that point in time, I would have paid VAT on this particular laptop. So now the question is, if I am disposing of this laptop, I am giving it away to somebody without consideration, can one say that it is supply of goods? Schedule 2, clause 4 says that this can be regarded as supply of goods. So the answer to that question would be, since I have not availed any ITC, being a practicing chartered accountant, I wouldn't have availed input tax credit. Being an advisor, being a service provider, I was not eligible to claim set off ITC of VAT, and I have not claimed any input tax credit in respect of GST. Therefore, if I dispose of this laptop in current regime, in GST regime, without consideration, then it may not be regarded as supply at the first place, and therefore there won't be any GST. One need not look at whether it is supply of goods or services. The second aspect, the clause B of item number 4 of Schedule 2 says, where by or under the direction of a person carrying on a business, goods held or used for the purpose of the business are put to any private use, or are used or made available to any person for use for any purpose other than of purpose of business, whether or not for a consideration, the usage or making available of such goods is a supply of service. So if I have purchased this laptop in my company, where I would have availed the input tax credit, or like where I would have used it, I mean where I would have purchased, and then say for example, after the office hours, I am using this laptop to search some of my information, some of my personal queries on Google, say for example. So then when I am putting this laptop to my personal use, then in such a case, will that be regarded as supply of goods? Is there any duality of two persons? Is there any, is it in the course or furtherance of business? Is it for a consideration? Answer seems clear, no. And then this 4B says that this would be regarded as supply of services. Now friends, you will agree that since after the amendment which has been made right from the day one of the GST implementation, since it cannot be characterized as supply at the first place, therefore it cannot be considered to be supply of services, and therefore it will not attract GST. So I would say considerable amendment which will change various scenarios. Now the questions could be like, what will happen to the taxes which I would have already paid? Can I claim those taxes back? We'll come to that question little later. Meanwhile, let's see that what is the impact of this amendment in other areas of Schedule 2. So friends, I was talking about that House of Lords judgment. So this is the basically judgment of House of Lords of UK. It's like a 1987 judgment. The judgment says the word supply in its ordinary natural meaning conveys the ideal of furnishing or providing to another something which is wanted or required in order to meet the wants or requirements of the other. So first of all, it is the need of the, there has to be two persons, one who is the supplier, the other one who is the recipient. And then this supplier should be in order to mitigate the requirements, the need of the another person. So if there is no other person, there cannot be any transaction be called as supply. Then it says further, it connotes more than the mere transfer of physical control of some chattel or object from one person to another. So it talks about two aspects. First of all, there should be two persons, and it should be at the will and desire of the recipient. It cannot be simply thrown upon him. So unless there is a contrary definition to this kind of understanding in the specific taxation law, there cannot be like extrapolated meaning derived out of the term supply and it can be taxed. So in normal parlance, unless like in the schedule 1 scenario, one can understand that there are some specific situations which have been listed over there, and it's mentioned that whether there is consideration or not, there could not be a presence of any other elements required for supply, but still it would be regarded as supply for levying taxes. So barring those situations, in normal scenario, it cannot be considered to be supply. Coming to the another scenario of item number 4, that is clause C, it says where any person ceases to be a taxable person, any goods forming part of the assets of any business carried on by him shall be deemed to be supplied by him. So if say for example I am CA Jayesh Gogri, say for example if I am having one GST and registration number in my personal name and I am holding certain assets in my company, telephone, mobile, laptop, and then if I am for whatever reasons I am stopping my business, if I am like putting it on hold, and now I want to be part of some partnership firm, so I am closing down this my proprietorship concern, merely my act of ceasing to be a taxable person as an individual, because I will be surrendering my GSTN number, even though I have not given anybody this assets of mine to anybody, I have not taken any money from anybody, still merely because of this clause C, it was giving an impression that yes, this would be legal, regarded as a supply. It is said that it will be deemed to be supplied by him. Now the question would be that now the section 7(1)(a) says, which we have recently saw, where certain activities or transactions constitute a supply in accordance with the provisions of subsection 1. It's only and only in accordance with subsection 1, and section 7(1) deals with now only 3 situations after the deletion of clause D. So which requires like schedule 1 without consideration and the other activities for consideration. So in such case only it can be regarded as supply. So now after the amendment, can there be a deemed supply? Should I look at schedule 2 at all? So again, this could be leading to a very big question that when it's not considered to be supply at all as per subsection 1, I did not look at the classification, and therefore for I will not ever come to schedule 2, and therefore I will not look at this section 4c, and therefore it may not be regarded as supply. Now friends, you will agree that this is my personal opinion which I am expressing. It could be, it may or may not be accepted by the departmental tax authorities. One may have to probably like litigate and fight to prove it. But as I am saying that this is my personal opinion, this is not my opinion of the company GSC Intime Service Private Limited, that once a particular activity, if it is not fitting within the definition of supply as per section 7.1, I did not look at subsection 1A, which says that you look at schedule 2 for classification. If there is no supply, no classification. The definition of business, which I would say that supply or acquisition of goods, including capital goods and services in connection with commencement or closure of business. Now it says supply or acquisition of goods even in the closure of business. So if I am closing down my business, so the example which we took, that if I am closing down my proprietorship concern, in if I am joining some partnership firm, then if I supply some capital goods, though it is in the course of closure, it will be regarded as supply. That's what the definition of business says. The point is that if I am supplying certain capital assets, even in the course of closure, it will be regarded as supply. It will be considered to be business. But if I am not supplying to anybody, if I am just having these assets with me, I am not supplying to anybody, I am not charging consideration, there is no other person, I am just having these assets with myself, then merely the fact of closure of business, merely fact of being ceased to be a taxable person, will not impact and probably will not give any rise of supply or GST. The another item number 5 of schedule 2 talks about construction of a complex building, civil structure or a part thereof. Till that point in time, it's okay. That normally if a contractor does a construction activity, then he is considered to be a supplier, okay, and then it goes further. It says including a complex or building intended for sale. So in the second case, the provider, the person is not actually constructing for somebody. It is like constructing for himself, but he is intending to sell it to somebody. He wants to sell it. Then, wholly or partly, except where the entire consideration has been received after issuance of completion certificate, where required by the competent authority or after its first occupation, whichever is earlier, was considered to be supply of services. The item number 5 says that this following transaction would be considered to be supply of services. Now again, the point is when a person is constructing something which is intended for sale, maybe after OC, maybe post before OC, but he is willing to sell, mere the act that he is intending to sell will make him liable to pay tax if he sells those properties before getting the completion certificate. That is the item number 5A of list 2. Now again, let's go back to section 5, section 7, subsection 1. Is it a supply? Is it supply of goods or service? Again, it could be a big question that whether the immovable properties, which are maybe to be maybe at the half made stage, or which are like proposed to be made on a future date, can it be regarded as supply of services and therefore would attract GST? The first question, because the way defined, the word service has been defined, it gives an impression that it's of a wide gamut. But again, there are like certain questions around this area, that can you give service such a wide kind of connotation that anything other than goods, so including like human beings, in that sense human beings are not goods, so therefore the term service is so wide that it would include even human beings. Now therefore one has to like ponder around this concept. But again, I would say after this amendment made in the section 7.1 and 1A, I feel that this may require a re-examination and it can open up various issues like Pandora's box. Then the other activity, like agreeing to the obligation to refrain from an act or to tolerate an act or a situation or to do an act. Now friends, we just saw the House of Lords judgment, which says that at the request of the recipient, if the supplier does something. Now agreeing to do obligation, if I am tolerating some act for somebody, first of all, whether it would be regarded as supply Again, this also may require a reconsideration in the light of this amendment, and one need to discuss about that, is there any supply, even though there could be some consideration for this, and therefore whether it would be regarded as supply of service. So this section, the about section 4 and 5, I would say section 4 is like more on a strong footing, whereas 5, the item number 5 of schedule 2 requires little thinking, requires little reconsideration, and in certain scenarios one may take a stand that this may not be called as supply, whereas in some other factual scenarios it may be regarded as supply of services. Item number 7 of schedule 2 deals with the supply of goods by the club to its members and says it will be like regarded as deemed supply of goods. Now the question again here, as we were discussing, that whether a club and member, are they two different persons or they are the same person? So far various high courts have held that there is a concept of mutuality, and club and members, they cannot be separated from each other, they are one and the same. Club is nothing but an association, the collection of members. Now in that scenario, since as we discussed, the term supply requires presence of two persons unless something specifically mentioned in schedule 1, or otherwise something specifically mentioned other way around, like the branches are considered to be separate persons even though they may be of the same persons in different states, or different registration of the same person are considered to be separate persons. So unless there is a specific mention about that, so if a club is supplying certain goods to members, there are various judgments to say that it's because of concept of mutuality, they are not two different persons. Of course, now this matter has reached to the larger bench of Supreme Court. This was like in the case of Calcutta Club Limited. The Supreme Court has referred this matter to the larger bench, and it's pending before now the larger bench of the Supreme Court. But till date, there are like n number of high court judgments which provide that this would be regarded as transactions of mutuality and therefore no income tax. And in the service tax regime also, there were like various judgments to say there is no service which is rendered. Now again, these questions would come up for the consideration that now, since there is no declaratory element in the schedule 2, and therefore can one argue that since, because just mere finding place in schedule 2, item number 7, it won't be considered as supply, and therefore even though it is mentioned that this supply by a club to the unincorporated association or body of persons to a member would be called as supply of goods, but actually since it is not a supply, one may take a stand that this may not be regarded as supply. However, of course, the final answer would be known to us only when the larger bench delivers the proper judgment on this matter. Meanwhile, basis high court judgments, one may take that kind of view. Friends, there is another important amendment made in the CGST Act with regard to the term supply, and that is the amendments made in Schedule 3. Basically, Schedule 3 deals with various situations, various activities which are not considered to be supply at all. It's neither supply of goods nor supply of services. So there are like various items already mentioned in Schedule 3. Now there are like few items which have been added recently. So basically there were like items, list of 6 items, and now the 7th item had been added to Schedule 3, which says supply of goods from a place in the non-taxable territory to another place in the non-taxable territory without such goods entering into India. We'll discuss this aspect in the next slide. The another amendment which has been made is adding the item number 8A, which says supply of warehoused goods to any person before clearance for home consumption. Now what is this warehouse goods? We'll discuss. And the clause B of 8 says, item number 8 says, supply of goods by the consignee to any other person by endorsement of documents of title to the goods after the goods have been dispatched from the port of origin, which is located outside India, but before clearance for home consumption. Now, what is this clearance for home consumption, etc., we'll discuss in the next slide. And there is explanation 2 which has been added to the entire schedule. Now, this explanation 2 says, for the purpose of paragraph 8, the expression warehouse goods shall have the same meaning as assigned to it in the Customs Act. So, warehouse goods need not be like normally what we understand by warehouse. It has to be warehouse goods as per the definition of Customs Act. So, we need to look at what is there in the Customs Act. So, let's now look at the addition to item number 7 and 8. This item number 7 deals with out and out transaction. It's in commercial parlance, it's called as out and out transaction. Friends, you may see that there is, on one hand, there is a China, which is like red color flag. There is another country, USA. Now, the person in India, which is below, he gets an order from USA to supply certain goods. Now, instead of supplying from India, he is procuring those goods from China, and from China directly he delivers to USA, or he may ask even his supplier of China to directly deliver to US. In that question, in that scenario, the question was, will there be any GST liability to a person which is located in India? So, in that regard, there was an advance ruling from Kerala Advance Ruling Authority in the case of Synthite Corporation, and then they came to a conclusion that this is no supply, it won't be regarded as supply. However, you will understand that advance ruling is applicable only to the applicant in that case and the department in that case. So, one may take the ratio, but it is not applicable to general public. So, it was requiring a clarification, which has been brought now by insertion of item number 7 in schedule, and henceforth it would be regarded as like this out and out transactions. Now, this amendment act would be implemented from 1st Feb 2019. So, 1st Feb 2019, from onwards, that date onwards, the transactions which are like supply of goods from one place, one outside India, to another place outside India, would be not considered as supply and therefore will not attract any GST. The second situation which we were dealing was warehouse goods, and since it was making a reference to the Customs Act, therefore it's very essential to look at the definition of warehouse goods as per the Customs Act. It says warehouse goods means goods deposited in a warehouse. Now again, the term warehouse has been well defined in the Customs Act, and it says means a public warehouse licensed under section 57 or a private warehouse licensed under section 58. So, warehouse doesn't mean any warehouse. It has to be a licensed premise, and that too under a particular section, which is section 57 or 58. Only if a particular place which is licensed under section 57 or 58 of Customs Act, then only it can be called as warehouse, and then only the goods stored in this warehouse would be called as warehouse goods. And then, as we discuss in item number 8A, supply of warehouse goods to any person before clearance for home consumption. So, clearance for home consumption means like on payment of duty when the goods are cleared from the warehouse. So, this warehouse is little interesting concept, where if the goods are imported from abroad to India, normally one has to pay customs duties as soon as they reach the customs border of India. But if the person doesn't want to pay duties upfront, he wants to like pay duties at a later date, he can store these goods into the licensed warehouses under the Customs Act. Till the time goods are lying in that customs warehouse, licensed warehouse, one need not pay any taxes or duties, only when he clears it for home consumption, that is like when he wants to consume for his operations within India, then only he has to pay duty. Now, it may happen when the goods are lying in the license warehouse, he may find another customer and instead of clearing for himself, he can directly transfer the title to another person. The question was, goods have already come to India. At the intermediate stage, when the goods are lying in this warehouse, when if somebody, one Indian supplying to another Indian, will that transaction be called as supply? Now, there were like rounds of circulars. Firstly, the department was opinion that this would be regarded as supply, will attract GST. Then there was another circular which said that the duty would be payable only at the stage of clearance and not before that. And now, of course, that circular was issued in the May 2018, but was made effective from 1st April 2018. So the question was, from 1st July 17 to March 18, there was a dilemma kind of a situation, which now this Schedule 3 is amended from 1st Feb 2018, and now it clearly says that it won't be regarded as supply at all. It's neither supply of goods nor supply of services, and therefore no GST. Now again, the question would remain about the past period of July 17, 1st July 17 to 31st March 18, that what will be the scenario? Now, can this amendment, though it is made effective from 1st Feb 2019, can it be made retrospectively applicable, saying that this is nothing but clarificatory kind of amendment? It is clarificatory amendment and therefore it should be applied from beginning, from 1st July 17 itself. Answer to that may be yes, because the circular also, which was issued in May 2018, was giving such kind of clarification. And clarification used to say that since any transaction which is in the course of import is to be dealt with as per the Customs Act, and Customs Act always levies duties when the goods are cleared for home consumption from the customs frontiers, and the license warehouses are considered to be within the customs frontiers. So as long as the goods are lying within the customs frontiers, there are no taxes to be paid as per the Customs Act. So the circular said that ultimately it is in the course of import and therefore like the Customs Act will look into that. So reading this circular and this amendment together, one may take a stand that this amendment is clarificatory in nature and therefore it would be applicable right from 1st July 17, even though the law has been amended for this with this regard from 1st Feb 2019. Now friends, this was some of the important amendments with regard to the term supply, particularly the amendments in Schedule 2 and Schedule 3. I would be like happy to assist you. If you need any further clarification in this regard, you can write to us at the email link which is provided in this video. Thank you for watching this.